Good morning. Open your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 7, and we are going to finish our study on royal relationships and the Davidic kingdom. Let me try this again, too. He is risen.
He is risen.
Hallelujah. We all have different traditions we come out of, don't we? And somebody, I think it was Lori, said that when we were back there, and she said, "He is risen." And I was like, "He is risen indeed, hallelujah." And then I'm like, "Oh yeah, we don't do that hallelujah part here." I got in that from the Lutherans. So, always are good. So, yeah, we're going to finish this up. And when Randy was talking about what he did on his 40-day journey, I thought it was shaving, Randy. I noticed you don't have your mustache.
Randy, it's a fat one. You have whiskers.
Oh. They did away with them. Okay. All right. So let's pray and let's get started. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for everybody here. And God, as we go into this, this is the day we remember the miracle that you have done. We remember the miracle you performed. We remember that exact day where you rose from the dead. But what we remember for those of us who are believers is that day we put our faith in you. We put our faith in the promise that you made to David thousands of years ago. And fulfilled in Christ Jesus our Lord. So now, God, as we gather today in your name to remember that, let us not just remember, but let us rejoice. Let us walk out of here today, not with just the promise, but with power, God, remembering your faithfulness and your love for all your people. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, we're going to pick up right away. As we've, like I said, we've been in this study for a long time, and we've gone through, we started with the whole study of the Davidic kingdom, starting with Hannah, and we just kind of kept moving right along, and we finally went through all the life of David, and we got all the way up, and so last week, we finally came to the part where David has not just become king, but he's brought the ark back to Israel, and now he's fully won. I mean, it couldn't get any better than this, right? I mean, this is it. He's dancing, he's feeding people. Things couldn't get any better. And he makes this public declaration that he's not going to stop praising God and nothing's ever going to hold him back. And right after that, as he sits down, he comes to this realization in his life. This realization where it's not just enough for God, the ark, for God's presence to just reside in a tent while he resides in a castle. It just doesn't sound right, does it? No, God's presence can't be in a tent and a man be in a castle. So he gets this idea and he says this. He says, you know what? This isn't right. And so what I'm going to do is I am going to build a temple for our Lord. And the prophet Nathan comes to him. And as he comes to David, he comes to him and he basically says, great idea, but you're not going to do it. No, that's not what you're going to do. I've got something better for you, David. See, you have too much blood on your hands, so I have not chosen you to do this. What you're going to do and what I'm going to give you is something else. I'm not going to give you a temporal building. I'm not going to give you a temporal kingdom. I am going to give you this. And if you pick up in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 12, it says this, "And when your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you. You have come, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom." How long? Forever. Okay, let's hold on to that. Now, what we call this right here is a covenant, or the Davidic covenant. And for all of us, let's just call it a promise, if you will. But it's more than just like, when I was a kid and I really wanted the Super Nintendo Entertainment System, and that came out and had the power pad on it, I went and I made a promise to my dad and I wrote a little contract and I said, I'll run on the power pad every day because I was chunky and I needed to lose weight. And I said, if you just buy me this, I'll run every day. And that was kind of like a promise we make. And we make promises like that all the time, but I didn't slim down, did I, Dad? No, I didn't. No, I didn't even use the power. I figured I could just bump my hands on it, make the guy run really fast. Got out of exercise. So, no, we're used to promises being made, but a covenant, that's a personal promise that we're going to make and we're going to continue to go with each other. And so God makes this promise with David. It's not just that you're going to have a kingdom, but I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be with your family. It's going to be forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Praise God. Amen? And so this idea of a covenant or a promise is hard for a lot of us to really wrap our minds around because we're familiar with people breaking promises, are we not? We see it every day. Come on. And I can't, I got to be an equal opportunity person here. But how many of us remember, okay, not too long ago, this promise, you will keep your doctors. Didn't work. Now let me be an equal opportunity person. Read my lips. No new taxes. Two promises that were not fulfilled, were they? No. See, we are used to people in high positions of authority making big promises to us and letting us down. And it's not just religious figures, okay? We're used to, how many of you remember about 5 years ago, Pastor Ted Haggard? Remember him? Oh yeah, I see a few hands in the back. He was the leader of the Family Coalition. He was the most outspoken person against same-sex marriage there was. He went to Congress. He legislated. He got up. He got on huge national platforms, and he told everybody about this abomination of same-sex marriage, and only to find out what? He was constantly in an active relationship with another man and doing meth along the way. A pastor of a church of 10,000 with a national broadcast. We're used to religious figures letting us down. We're used to public leadership letting us down. And some of us are used to, or have seen some, or have experienced somehow, divorce. We've seen marriages and families that have broken and let us down. We've had our jobs that have made promises to us let us down. We've had friends make promises to us. They've let us down. And some of you have children that have made promises to you, and they've let you down. And some of us have made promises to our parents, and we've let them down. The reality is the idea of keeping a promise in this world is almost unfathomable at times. And the only person in all of known human history that has been faithful to keeping said promises is God. God started with a promise in Eden, and he said as they kicked him out, I will put enmity between the serpent and man. And we call that the Noahic covenant. And then after he floods the earth through Noah, or after the time of Noah, he makes a promise with Noah. He says, I will never ruin the earth with water again. And we call that the Noahic covenant. And then when Abraham goes out and he says, I will make you the father of not just Israel or the Hebrews, but of all nations, we call that the Abrahamic covenant. And then we hear about Moses going up on the Mount Sinai, coming down with the Ten Commandments, and he makes a promise with the Israelites. And when he makes that promise with the Israelites, we call that the Mosaic Covenant. And within that covenant, or that promise, he says, if you, then, if you, then, if you, then. It's a conditional covenant. Do you understand what I'm talking about? A conditional relationship. And then it doesn't work, as we start to find out after David. It just starts to fall apart. And so after this, and David rises up before it all falls apart, David has, where I'm talking about now, this desire to build a temple. But God comes to David and he says this, again, one more time, he says, the Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. And when those days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up an offspring to succeed you, who will come from your own body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build the house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And this is what we call the Davidic covenant. We see God fulfilling promise after promise after promise after promise, and all these promises continue to move forward and build on one another. And as David's temporal kingdom, his sons and his generation, continue to run against pagan gods, and God finally takes it away, this worldly kingdom that was established through David's bloodline disappears. And it goes away for almost 400 years. Enter Jesus. As Jesus comes on the scene. We know in Matthew chapter 1, as I've talked about almost a year ago at this time, as we started into that series, okay, that Jesus was the son of who? David. He was the son of Abraham. He was the son of David, fulfilling those covenants, fulfilling those promises. We know that first, Matthew goes out of his way to make sure, and quoting all this Old Testament, to say Jesus fulfilled that check mark. Then we know he was born of a virgin in Matthew 1:23, quoting the Old Testament. He fit that check mark. Then we know he was born in Bethlehem, the city of David, in Matthew 2:6. Click that check mark. And then we know how he taught. He taught in parables. And as he started teaching in parables, which were really just worldly situations, Jesus wasn't that much of an expository preacher. He was more of an illustrative kind of guy, and he taught in these almost riddles, and they were called parables. And as he would teach them, it was cited by the author of Matthew. He quoted an Old Testament passage in Matthew 3:13-5, and it said, another check. Then it said he'd be rejected by the religious leaders of the day in Matthew 21:42. Check. And then all of a sudden it says he'd be betrayed by his followers as his followers run away from him. Matthew 26:31. Check. Now all these New Testament sightings have an Old Testament promise. They are prophecies fulfilled. And as Jesus has come on the scene, particularly in the Gospel of Matthew, he is portrayed solely as the King of Kings. And every time one of these promises is fulfilled, it's like another check mark, another check mark, another check mark. In comes Good Friday. In comes the crucifixion. Now, if you go back and you read Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53, it is almost word for word exactly what Jesus went through. It is almost exactly what Jesus went through. Psalm 22 starts off with what Jesus will quote on the day he's crucified, almost 1,000 years earlier, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Or when Jesus is standing on the cross, 1,000 years later, speaking Aramaic, he yells, what? Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? As he dies. And then it continues to go on, talk about how his bones are being broken. Or Isaiah talks about this suffering servant. We've all heard it. We know it. Okay, so we have all of this in the crucifixion. And we know at this point, if you've been a good reader of the Old Testament, that Jesus has checked off every mark you need to be this promised king from the lineage of David. But what's different? This guy went to the cross and he died for our sins. And it confounded, if not baffled, his most devout followers. It confounded everybody. And they didn't know what to do. And so they go away. But on the third day, on this day, as the ladies went to the temple to take care of his body, or the tomb where he was, and the stone was rolled open, and an angel was there, where was Jesus? He wasn't there. Why was he not there? Why? Because he is risen? Hallelujah. He is risen indeed. He rose. The angel said, you don't need to look here anymore. He's up. He's not dead. He's alive. And because he fulfilled every one of those things, and because his blood was shed, no longer the shedding of a blood of an animal to atone for your sins one time of the year, no longer the shedding of an animal to atone for the sins of the Israelites, but now the blood shed of God in the flesh for all people, Jew, Gentile, male, female, rich, poor, it doesn't matter. That blood was shed for everybody, and it made the most difference when he rose from the dead, because at that point, he defeated the only thing we can never defeat. And what is that? Death. He defeated death. And what does this all mean? It means God fulfilled his promise. And why does that seem to confound us? Because we're not used to people fulfilling promises. But God fulfilled this promise. Did he do it in the way they thought they would? Absolutely not. They didn't expect God to come down in the flesh, die on a cross, and raise up out of a grave. So not just the Jews could know him, but all people could know him. Now, I need you to get this part. Because most of us in America have heard this. God fulfilled that promise. And simply by believing in that promise, by accepting that promise, by making the conscious decision to fulfill that promise and to accept that promise, you will become a new creation in Christ. We will become born again. The problem is, and this is the second part of my message. First part, I think most of us heard it. It's called the gospel, the good news. Now, I think a lot of people come on Easter because they're trying to figure out, why do I have this promise, and yet I have this life that doesn't quite seem to be fulfilled. I mean, I don't feel like I have the same zeal and devotedness like Josephina, who just smuggled a bunch of Bibles into Mexico. I don't seem to have the perkiness of Randy Perkins. Why is it I don't have that? Is something broken in me? Why doesn't this work? Why don't I have the desire to memorize the entire book of James? Why don't I have the desire to go on a mission trip? What is wrong with me? Why do I keep sinning? Why do I keep doing these things? Why don't I have a desire to come and worship the risen Lord? Do you hear me? Because we know a lot of people like that, don't we? Including ourselves sometimes. Now here's the point I want to make, and I want to illustrate it like this. Probably at the worst point in my life, there was a man named Paul. His birthday was yesterday. Fitting name for a man who's going to lead me to the Lord, right? So there was a man named Paul, and he was going to go off to be a missionary in Poland. And as he's raising his funds, and he worked with me to become a full-time missionary, I was his little pet project. This guy was going to lead me to the Lord no matter what happened. This guy was going to lead me to Jesus, okay? And he was everything I wasn't. I am telling you, okay, the guy had never even, I don't even think he had been around a pack of cigarettes, okay? If a beer commercial came on, it went off. I mean, that's how he grew up. And then you got enter Ben. And he's watching me get high every day. He's watching me get drunk. And he's always trying to tell me about Jesus. And anytime he can work his way in to tell me about the Lord, he's doing it. And one day, I messed up and said, they were talking about like fishing trips or something like that. Okay, and the most fishing I ever done was on, you know, South Twin Lake, dumping in a little thing with a bobber and pulling up bluegill. I mean, that takes no strategy. You just drop it in and pull it, drop it in and pull it. Okay, I'd never really fished like a man. And they were talking about fishing like that. And I was like, well, I've never done that before. And ding, the light went off of Paul. I'm going to take you fishing. And I'm thinking, oh no, I'm stuck. And because he had a date. And he's like, oh, we go to Traverse City every year. It's where they release all the salmon. And it's trout, salmon. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It's a certain kind of fish, okay? You can tell I never fished again after this. I just let the story go. Okay, so every year they release these fish. And so he and his brother, who's also a pastor, these are not the people I want to hang out with, and they ain't the dudes I roll with, okay? They are going to take me on this trip. So I'm like, sure, I'll do that. I had no intentions of doing it. As a matter of fact, the only plan I made was, when he showed up at my house at 1 in the morning for us to drive up to Traverse City, I wasn't going to be there. That was my plan. And so I come stumbling in about 3 in the morning, lit up, and guess who's sitting there? Paul and his brother. You ready to go fishing? Oh, Lord. So I didn't even have the strength to fight. It had been a good night, so I'm like, whatever, man, all right. So I go back, I fill up a flask, and then I put this in my pocket, and we get in the car, it's dark, and we just start going on to Traverse City, Michigan, and I'm just sipping in the back, okay? Mind you, I've been partying all night, and now I'm sipping another 4 hours all the way up to Traverse City. So it's fair to say I was intoxicated. Okay, like I don't know how else to put it, quite intoxicated. And I remember I did not know the Lord at this point in my life. So finally, it's like, I don't know, sunbreak, and we pull out, and we're going out in the middle of the woods, and I only like real thought I remember at that point was thinking I'm in a cult because these guys are driving me into the woods in the middle of nowhere. And we park our car, and we get out, and they give me a fishing rod, okay, and I remember when I went back, I remember thinking, when we were still at my apartment, I'm like, man, we gotta go fishing. I remember thinking, I don't know what fishermen wear, so I got like a flannel shirt, you know, like I dressed like a L.L. Bean catalog, okay? And so we get out, and they give me a pole, and we get this pole, and now, okay, remember, I'm not with it. And so I've got this fishing pole looking like LLB man, and then we're walking like another mile over the crest of this hill to go fishing. And as we come over the crest of this hill, I am not kidding you, any fisher person in here knows this. There were like 1,000 people on the shore. I'm not kidding. I'm like, I don't know where they came from. I don't know who they were, but they were out there. And they had like, you know, the pants you stand in the water on, and they had way better fishing poles than I had. And they knew what they were doing, and they're casting and doing all this stuff. And here I am looking like LLB man walking down the thing, probably with a, you know, $10 Walmart pole. And so I go out there. I don't have anywhere to stand, so I just throw a pole. I caught something. It was a man in front of me down the rocks. He was so angry with me. And then I'm like, I'm sorry. And he came over and he said, son, you see that rock? You go stand on that rock. I'm going to put you on that rock. And so I go out and I stand on the rock. Now the water's moving. I'm standing on a rock. I'm throwing something. Water's moving, standing still, and I'm intoxicated. This does not work well, does it? And I bet you can guess what happens, can't you? I fall into the water. And now I'm wet because I don't have the pants on. And because I don't have the pants on, and I'm wet, and I got the cheap pole, and I don't got the good pole, I'm mad. So you know what I do? I pick up the pole, and I huff and puff and walk a mile all the way back to Paul and his brother, like, come back, come back. I'm like, you shut up. And so I go all the way back, and I go back to the car, and I sleep it off. I sleep it off, and I wake up. And I'm a little more, you know, with it at this point. And I'm sitting there angry because I realize we ain't going home until it's dark. And so I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to let this get the best of me. I'm not like that. I'm a winner. And I'm going to go out there. I'm going to catch me a fish. So I picked that pole back up with my soggy wet pants. And I walked all that way back down there. I'm talking like a mile, like, you know, old people say they walked up the hill in snow. Okay, like, I don't know how far it was. And so I'm going all the way back down. And I go back down. And as soon as I walk down, I don't wait to get on rocks. I don't wait for other people. There's like an entrance path. And I take my pole and I throw it. I throw it. And the line goes. Click, click, and my pole instantly went, and I'm like, yeah, I got a fish, and I'm, and people are like, no, kid, no, and I'm like trying to grind it, okay, and they're like, no, no, people come over, my pole is literally like down, and I'm like, I got it, and so people are telling me to stop, people are trying to help me, I'm like, no, finally, I take the pole and start running down the path, taking people out with fishing line the whole way down. And I actually pull by hand this fish onto the shore. I kid you not. And as I pull this fish up to the shore, some police cop guy comes down. He puts it down and he cuts it and he lets it swim away. I didn't even get to hold the fish. DNR officer, that's what they were. I said, what are you doing? He said, you can't catch a fish that way. It went through its eye or something like that. I'm like, oh, that's better. Just leave the blind fish go. I still don't understand that law. Now, why did I just tell you that story? It's really simple. And I'm going to tie this together for you right now. Having a fishing pole did not make me a fisherman, did it not? Just having a Bible doesn't mean anything, does it? Having a Jesus t-shirt doesn't mean anything. Going to the fishing hole didn't make me a fisherman, did it? Even going through the acts of being a fisherman did not make me a fisherman, did it? There was absolutely nothing I did that whole day, even catching a fish, that made me a fisherman. Even though I had the tools to do it, I had the people with me to do it, and I was in the place to do it, I wasn't a fisherman. And just like so many people gather together on Easter Sunday and they pontificate and question the same thing over and over again. Why do the people who come every week come? Why do the people like Josephina do what they do? What is different about them than me? It's simple. God fulfilled the promise, and you haven't fulfilled your end of the promise by buying into the promise. Until you buy into that promise and let Jesus become the Lord of your life, you will always live a half life. And it will not be a full life in Christ. You will not know this final point, okay? Because the promise becomes something much more. That gospel that I talked about earlier, Jesus fulfilling the promise, when you make that decision, it becomes the gospel, the good news in your life. And Paul says this, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is what? The power of God unto salvation. The gospel is power. It is power. And so those of us who do not have a power have only been hanging around with a promise. And until you buy into the promise on your end, because God's been faithful to fulfill His side of the story, you will never fulfill or see that power in your life. Why? Because it is what? It's power. It's power to bring you to new life in Christ. It's power to make you what? A new creation in Christ. It's the power that made us the righteousness of God. It's the power that made us adopted children of God. It's the power that Paul says we are no longer condemned, for we are in Christ Jesus. That's the power that inspires us to go out and do the things we do as believers in Jesus. That's why we gather today. Not to dress up. Not to come together and see our family. Not to make mashed potatoes downstairs. That's all awesome stuff. But we come because I know this. One, God made a promise. But two, we come because we've either accepted that promise and we've seen that power fulfilled in our lives, or we come and we wonder, why don't I have that power in my life? And I'll tell you this right now, as we close. If you have been wondering, why is there no power in my life? I suggest and submit this to you on Resurrection Day. Maybe, just maybe, God fulfilled His promise, and now it's time for you to buy into it and accept that promise. And not just wait halfway. Because I know deep down, all of us want that power. And some of you are like, if I get that power, do I have to be like you? No. There are lots of awesome, quiet Christians. Okay? But just like I wasn't that fisherman, coming here doesn't make you that new creation. Having the tools doesn't make you a new creation. It's only having Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your King, your Master, that will give you that power. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Almighty God, thank you for fulfilling your promises. Almighty God, for anyone in this room right now who has been walking through this, who has been wondering what is going on, who is tired of living a half life, who's tired of having a promise, I pray, God, that you would move in their heart in such a way that they would make a decision to follow you now, that they would turn their life over to you now, that they would no longer play games, that I pray, God, that that promise you fulfilled will become power in their life. And for those of us, oh God, who have maybe let the power go away, for those of us who have gotten caught up with our jobs, or others who didn't keep promises, our families, God, remind us of that power. Remind us of your grace. Remind us of your mercy. Help us, oh God, to live out the call you have in each one of our individual lives. Thank you for raising from the dead. Thank you for saving us. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said, Amen.